Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Uzma Jaffrey. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Wednesday, the 31st of March. India has not lost any territory to China, says Army Chief. Heart of Asia Declaration calls for further Afghan talks. And Bangladesh tightens measures to fight fresh wave of coronavirus. And now for all the details. Indian Army Chief General Manoj Mukund Naravne has said India has not lost out on any territory in the months-long military standoff with China in Ladakh region. He said, "We are where we were after the worst border conflict."
Indian Army Chief General Manoj Mukund Naravne has said that India has not lost out on any territory in the months-long military standoff with China in the Himalayan region of Ladakh. Naravne, while speaking to news agency ANI on Tuesday, said, "We are where we were after the worst border conflict between the two giant neighbors in decades that began last year." The remarks come as India and China disengaged from the most contentious Pangong Lake area in Ladakh last month, after extensive talks at both military and diplomatic levels. However, disagreement still exists, despite several rounds of talks since last year.
"Firstly, we have not lost out on any territory. We are where we were before this whole thing started. But as a result of this agreement, it has been reached on the principle of mutual and equal security. So I think that should be the way we look at this whole disengagement process, that it is serves the interests of both countries to have a very stable LAC and with less chances of any confrontation taking place."
Border conflicts between India and China began late April to May last year, which led to a violent clash in the Galwan Valley on the night of June 15 that led to casualties on both sides. It was the first time in more than 40 years that lives were lost in the border along the line of actual control.
In news from Pakistan, traders in Pakistan's Karachi city are struggling to make ends meet amid smart lockdown imposed to stem the third wave of coronavirus spread. Although they have been allowed to function for limited hours, businesses are bogged down by rules of operation and no government assistance.
Traders and business owners in Pakistan's financial capital Karachi have appealed the government to remove restrictions on them and give them free hand to operate amid smart lockdown in the city until April 15 to curb coronavirus spread. Business owners have said that opening of shops from 6 a.m. till 10 p.m. as per the government orders is not enough for sustainable operations, and they are facing huge losses as movement of people is also restricted. Sharjeel Goplani, the president of All City Tajir Ittehad, a traders association in Karachi, said that businesses have already been severely impacted and staring at an uncertain future amid continuous lockdowns and no government assistance.
"तो ये जो नुकसान पूरा करने में कम से कम हमें दो से तीन साल का वक्त चाहिए कि सही तरीके से कारोबार चलता रहे. तो माशी नुकसान आपके सामने हैं, हमारी अपनी जो इकोनॉमी का जो हाल हुआ है और महंगाई जो आपके सामने आई है, इन चीज़ों को काबू करने के लिए जब तक हमें गवर्नमेंट फ्री हैंड नहीं देगी और जल्द ज़्यादा कारोबार के औकात नहीं देगी तो उस वक्त तक इन चीज़ों पर काबू पाना मुश्किल हो जाएगा."
As of Wednesday, Pakistan reported 667,957 confirmed cases of coronavirus with 14,434 deaths so far. Pakistan's already fragile economy had only just been moving towards stability when the health crisis struck last year. Experts fear that the pandemic's economic fallout will considerably derail the country's recovery process.
Moving on, delegates from supporting countries as well as representatives from international organizations at the Heart of Asia, Istanbul, process conference on Tuesday issued a 30-point approach to promote peace and security in Afghanistan. Delegates announced in the declaration that they support the ongoing efforts for the peace process and the continuation of the negotiations between the Afghan government and the Taliban.
Delegates from participating and supporting countries as well as representatives from international organizations at the Heart of Asia Istanbul Process Conference on Tuesday issued a 30 points approach to promote Afghan peace and security in Afghanistan. Delegates announced in the delegation that they support the ongoing efforts for the Afghan peace and the continuation of the negotiations between the Afghan government and the Taliban. Afghan President Ashraf Ghani, in an address to the 9th Heart of Asia Conference to offer details on his government's plan for a potential UN-led conference in Turkey to be held soon, and he reiterated the need to conduct peace efforts within the country's constitution. The UN-led conference on Afghanistan is expected to be held in the near future with representatives from all the sides of the conflict.
More on news from Afghanistan. Gunman kills 3 female polio vaccination workers in the eastern Afghan city of Jalalabad on Tuesday, officials said, adding that a blast also rocked the provincial health department headquarters during the same time, but left no casualties. Unknown gunmen shot vaccination workers at 2 separate locations in Jalalabad, killing 2 volunteers and 1 supervisor in the polio immunization program, all of them women. There was no immediate claim of responsibility, and the Taliban also denied involvement. A wave of assassinations has hit urban centers recently, many of them targeting professional women as well as government employees and members of media. Afghanistan kicked off a polio vaccination program this week only, backed by the UNICEF. Afghanistan and Pakistan are the only countries in the world where polio remains endemic. In news from Nepal, Chairman of CPN Maoist Center Pushpa Kamal Dahal has filed a review petition at the Nepal Supreme Court challenging its decision to nullify the unification between the CPN-UML and the CPN Maoist Center. The verdict has further widened the rift between the ruling coalition.
Chairman of CPN Maoist Center Pushpa Kamal Dahal on Tuesday filed a review petition at the Nepal Supreme Court, challenging its decision to nullify the unification between the CPN-UML and the CPN-Maoist Center. The top court on March 7 scrapped the 2018 merger, as the unified party had chosen a name, Nepal Communist Party, that already belonged to another party registered with the Election Commission. Dahal said he hoped that the verdict would be corrected, as it was unnatural and political in nature, effectively preventing registration and operation of a political party, and questioned the legality of multiple NCP representatives, including the president and the vice president. Nepal's political sphere has witnessed a constant wave of highs and lows following Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli's move to dissolve the parliament last December, which was later deemed unconstitutional by the Supreme Court. There has been a turmoil again by the court's decision to annul the communist unification, which has further widened the rift between the ruling coalition.
Moving on to news from Bangladesh. Bangladesh has tightened measures and issued an 18-point directive as part of efforts to fight a new wave of infections. The country logged 5,358 new COVID-19 cases on Wednesday, the highest daily count on record, taking the tally of infections to over 611,290.
Bangladesh, struggling against a new wave of infections, has issued an 18-point directive, including reducing office attendance by 50% and restricting political and religious gatherings as part of efforts to curb surging COVID-19 cases. Bangladesh on Wednesday logged 5,358 new cases of the coronavirus, the highest daily count on record, taking the tally of infections to 611,295. The death toll climbed to 9,046 after 52 fatalities, the highest daily tally since August 26, were registered in the 24 hours. As part of measures other than the emergency services, all government and private offices and industrial units will have to be run with 50% workforce. It also directs ban on transport services in high-risk areas and restrictions on all religious, social, political and other gatherings. This comes as the South Asian nation has administered the first dose of COVID-19 vaccine to over 5.2 million people till date. The government is also discussing imposition of lockdowns in areas with high transmission rate, media reports said.
Youth in India's Jammu and Kashmir are trying to break barriers and stereotypes by participating in a fashion show, which is a rare event in the Himalayan territory, which has been at the heart of the decades-long conflict between India and Pakistan. And fashion industry is also an uncommon choice in the Muslim-dominated region.
Youth in India's Jammu and Kashmir attempt to break barriers and stereotypes by participating in a fashion show which was organized on Tuesday. Youngsters from at least 22 districts were auditioned and the selected participants were groomed in a 10-day workshop. Participants dazzled in Indian and Indo-Western fusion attires as they walked down the ramp in presence of the audience and Bollywood celebrities.
यहाँ पर मॉडलिंग शो रखा गया है, एक्चुअली अ फैशन शो जो लाइक कभी नहीं हुआ है कश्मीर में, क्योंकि यहाँ पर बहुत सारी ऐसी स्टीरियोटाइप्स है और ऐसी थिंकिंग है कि लड़कियाँ मॉडलिंग नहीं कर सकती, मॉडलिंग अच्छा नहीं है, वो जो करियर है वो बिल्कुल भी लाइक सही नहीं है, तो उसे ब्रेक करने के लिए ये आज शो रखा गया.
दिस इज़ द वन ऑफ द फर्स्ट ऑफ इट्स काइंड जो कश्मीर में हो रहा है, तो एवरीबडी इज़ वेरी एक्साइटेड. काफ़ी लोगों ने मेहनत की है और जो टैलेंटेड है, हु इज़ यू नो participating in this fashion, they have really worked very hard. So, yeah, looking forward to, you know, success for this event.
Fashion shows are a rare event in Srinagar, the capital city of Himalayan territory, which has been at the heart of the decades-long conflict between India and its nuclear-armed neighbor, Pakistan. Also, the fashion industry is an uncommon choice in the Muslim-dominated region.
At the world's largest religious festival, Kumbh Fair, an 18-inch tall dreadlocked Hindu ascetic considered as the world's smallest saint is grabbing eyeballs. The 55-year-old saint has become the center of attraction for devotees who are gathering to seek his blessings. Have a look.
An 18-inch tall dreadlocked Naga sadhu or Hindu holy man wearing rosary beads with dreamy eyes, considered as the world's smallest saint, is grabbing eyeballs at the Kumbh Mela, the world's largest religious festival being held in India. Narayan Nandgiri Maharaj, a 55-year-old saint, has become the center of attraction for devotees who seek his blessings in the northern pilgrimage town of Haridwar. Nandgiri Maharaj weighs 18 kilograms and cannot stand up or walk. He is looked after by his disciple Umesh.
सब दर्शन करते हैं, सबको अच्छा लगते हैं, सब सेल्फी लेते हैं, दर्शन करते हैं, माथा टेकते हैं, हर एक जगह जाते हैं.
Many of the ascetics who worship the Hindu god Shiva belong to the monastic orders called Akharas and live in remote caves, stepping out for the Kumbh Mela, generally held once every 3 years in 4 cities.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude the top stories once again. India has not lost any territory to China, says Army Chief. Heart of Asia Declaration calls for further Afghan talks. And Bangladesh tightens measures to fight fresh wave of coronavirus. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/sasianewsline and follow us on Twitter @sasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.